Yeah, sure, sure. Thank you very much, Serge, for the kind introduction, also for the updated CV, so thank you very much. Where are the students? Okay, good. So students on this side, and the permanent staff on the other side. Okay, so today we have to you especially. Yes, I'm speaking about a completely new technology that we are developing since these last years, and it is much more addressed to existing plants. So what we are doing today with CO2, because direct synthesis mentioned by my colleague Carlo are very interesting, they are the future, but we should still need to understand which kind of time we need to take them for applying really from a practical point. Okay? So this is the problem that we have. Every year, more or less, the average is that we have 33 gigaton per year of CO2 that we are releasing into the atmosphere. It's a lot. Okay? So, what we are doing today, now, while we are speaking, how much of this molecule we are reducing? Okay? So, first one is this plant. Do you know it? You know, urea plant? Fertilizers? You know? Okay. This is very interesting plant, but this huge plant is probably the largest plant in chemical processes. Okay? So whenever you want to see a large plant, you need to go to see the urea plant. Okay? It is also very expensive because it costs more or less 2 million of euros per square meter. Okay? If you want to buy a urea plant, you need a lot of money. Okay? But this is just to tell that exactly what Carlo said before. Well, CO2, if you want to reuse it, is terribly expensive. Terribly expensive. So, we have a lot of technologies that are recovering it upstream. You will see also today the Roman presentation about enhanced oil recovery. It is very interesting technology. But once we release it, if you want to reuse, it is terribly expensive. Okay? So, if we take all the urea plants worldwide, all together, okay, they are reusing this 187 megaton. Nothing. Half a percent of what we are using. Okay? And this is the largest market for CO2 reducing today. Okay? Then the other one is methanol synthesis, as mentioned in the former presentation. Well, we have the traditional synthesis starting from CO, but we have also the direct synthesis from CO2. But if we take all the methanol plants worldwide, we have this reused 58 megaton. Nothing. Okay? Then we can speak about a lot of new technologies, and we have dry farming. Also, our group is working on this in the biogas field. You know the biogas? You know? Fermentation of biomasses, can you obtain CO2 and methane? Then the methane is burned, but the CO2 goes to the atmosphere again. Okay? It was a bio source, but we are releasing them. But there are some technologies that can put them together and obtain syngas. Okay? Then we have the Sabatier or hydrogenation process already presented. Then we have the GTL or fission torch. Okay? But if we put them together worldwide, they are reusing nothing today. Okay? So, really, we are speaking a lot about them, but at the bulk, okay, large numbers, they are doing nothing today. Okay? We have just small plants. So, we have the problem of hydrogen, introduced by Professor Viola. Okay? Then we can use methane as a reducing agent for CO2. Because if you want to reuse, we need to reduce, okay? And then we have water, like hydrolysis, right? But it is energy expensive, okay? Well, there are also some other groups that are speaking about the reforming of methanol and ammonia. They are very interesting molecules because they are rich in hydrogen, as you can see, okay? NH3, CH3, and so on. But they are synthetic molecules, they are so expensive that we can't use for reducing a large number of CO2, okay, a large amount of CO2. So our idea is to use this one, H2S, do you know it? And you see it? If you see it, you need to escape. Okay, this little one. Okay? But this is a natural compound. Because in the gas field, you have a lot. In the Kashagan, you know the Kashagan gas field? You know it? Never heard about it? It's the largest exploited gas field worldwide. It's on the Caspian Sea. Okay? Well, here in Italy, we are using a little bit of that gas, okay, thanks to the pine sulfur. You can. Okay? Otherwise, you generate SO2. Okay? So you are generating grand challenges of etching phase, climate changing, global warming, okay? But not only with CO2, also with other compounds. Okay? So, in this case, we need to remove the sulfur content from fossil and renewable sources. Okay? And to do so, we need the hydrogen to transport the sulfur into H2S. So, all the oil refineries are producing CO2, but also H2S. Okay? So, it is also synthetic one. Now, today, whenever we have H2S, we need to use this process. Do you know it? Sulfur recovery unit or Claus process? You know? Well, very shortly, it is burning H2S. That's all. We burn it, we transform it into SO2, and then we convert SO2 and the remaining part of H2S into elemental sulfur and water. So elemental sulfur is not impacting, okay? Water is, okay, it's water. Okay, so in this process we are burning H2S, but burning it we are generating some emissions. Okay, good. The real problem, well, the real problem is that something was not here. Okay, good, sorry, it's my fault. The real problem is that we are burning a molecule that has a huge hydrogen content. It is a very interesting molecule. It is toxic, like other compounds, okay? There's a lot of it. You know what we are doing in the gas field for H2S? We are not burning. We are just recompressing up to 100, 200 bar, and then we are pressing it under the soil. Okay? Just to put under the carpet, you know? When you are at home and you have some dust, okay, you pick the carpet. It's okay, no one will look at it. Okay? Now we have a different approach, it's this one. We want to use H2S to reduce CO2 because they are together in the streams. They can be recovered with the same technologies because whenever I want to recover CO2, the same sweetening technologies with amine and washing, for instance, okay, can give us the possibility to take also H2S together. Okay? So if we have that together, H2S and CO2, thanks to special technology, special reactor, now I will explain it very fast, okay? We can generate syngas and, as the only byproduct, elemental sulfur that has a market. Very low price, but has a market, and water, but it's not us. Okay? So here, what I mean is that we are starting from two emissions, three moles of emissions, and we are generating 2 moles of syngas. We are not using anymore any source. We are not using fossil source. We are not using renewable source. We are just using emissions. Okay? So from emissions, we go back to syngas. Okay? Well, we have theoretically a good production, 67%, okay? But we also developed an energy self-sustainable structure because look at it. We have the etching gases, these are etching gases, okay? We enter into a gas-gas heat exchanger. They are preheated a little bit. We go from 200 Celsius degree to 600, 700, okay? Then we move into a thermal step. Why thermal? Well, consider that we are speaking about existing plants and we are speaking about etching gases. they are completely full of impurities. Okay? So if we want to apply biofilm-based technology, we need to be robust. Okay? We don't need to stop every day because of some impurities. We can't use catalysts. Okay? So there's a thermal step to destroy all the impurities, but also to have a very good conversion of CO2 because of its thermal stability. Okay? Then after this thermal step, here the temperature is large, but we can supply it by air or oxygen. We are not burning, we are just oxidizing a very small part of H2S, just to sustain thermally this process. Okay? We are not burning it anymore, just very small amount of oxygen or air. Then after this we have a quench, because we have kinetics here and we need to shut down the possible recombination of radical species back to H2S. Okay? And then we exit into the gas-gas process side and we have the whole signals, this. Okay? So this is exactly what we developed. And now we have the pilot here in Sotocango. Also this morning we will have a campaign with Eusebio and Caterina Frau. So if we don't see me anymore at the school, probably we get some problems with H2S. Okay? I hope to see you again. So well, just an example, look at this. This is non-optimal feedstock, because we have an optimal feedstock. This is non-optimal feedstock with H2S and CO2, and non-optimal operating conditions. And as you can see, the CO2 that is very stable thermally, you need to go beyond 1,400 Celsius degree to attack CO2, okay? At relatively low temperature, I'm speaking about 1,000 and something, okay? 0.5% is converted into CO. And H2S is converted into hydrogen and sulfur. And then we have also water that is not in the bottom, okay? So it is effective technology. Now, how to introduce it for real process? Here we have the etching gases coming from coal gasification, oil refinery, shale oil treatment, whatever you want, okay? And here we have the washing, any washing, to sequester it, CO2 and H2S. You can do it together. Okay? Simultaneously. Okay? So this stream is sent to the regenerative thermoreactor. We call this regenerative thermoreactor. Okay? So we can send the etching gases to this reactor and we obtain the raw signals. Then we need to condensate the elemental sulfur here to water. Then we have some catalytic bath, because since we are injecting a little bit of air or oxygen, we are producing a small portion of SO2 inside, because we are oxidizing a little bit of H2S. You remember it? Just for energy self-sustainability. Okay? So here, thanks to the fact that we are not converting all the H2S, we can remove SO2, transforming it into elemental sulfur and water, like in the traditional Claus process. But it is just a small part, it's 1%. Okay? The rest is still C-gas that goes into another catalytic bed, because we are also generating, you know, it is a thermal step. So there are inside 2,000 reactions. Okay? And we are producing some organosulfur compounds, COS and CS2. But there are some catalysts very effective to transform them back into CO2 and H2S. We are speaking about 100 ppm, okay? Very small things. But we need to do, because at the end of the day, once we recover back the non-reacting species, H2S and CO2, we need the C-gas to be converted on catalytic steps that can be poisoned by these species and these species. Okay, so we need to recover them. Although they are few ppm, we need to convert them. Okay? But as you can see, we are using CO2 and H2S emissions. We are obtaining sulfur and water as byproduct, but we are also obtaining whatever you want. We are not exploiting any source of our planet, just emissions. Okay, this is the key point. Well, we have these two technologies, etching gas to sea gas and etching gas to liquid. We can transport the etching gases into methanol, ammonia, or whatever we want to. Okay, some benefits is that we are producing sea gas from wastes, but especially we are exploiting sulfur-rich resources. We have a lot of resources that are rich in sulfur. Just an example, the coal in the Inner Mongolia region in China has the 18% of sulfur. They can't use it. At least they are saying that they are not using it. Okay? But these sulfur-rich resources give us the possibility to reduce more CO2, to reduce the impact. So now we are inverting the viewpoint on the resources. Okay? The more the sulfur content, the better the environmental impact of the process. Because we can reduce more CO2 because we will have more sulfur to be converted. Okay? So here we have also the possibility, we are studying it together with Professor Miola, the possibility to have the synthesis of methanol starting from coal, but CO2-free. We need just to understand what will prevent this system. Well, we are just trying to optimize the sulfur content in the sources to have no emission of CO2. How much sulfur we need not to have any emission? Okay? Because we can also spoil intentionally the reserves by sulfur. We can spoil it. Okay? We can put inside the sulfur. Okay? Well, this is an estimation of the Kuhn Group in the UK. They are telling that AG2S is not solving the problem. Because today, with the current fossil sources adopted, we can produce, we can use 44 megaton per year of CO2. Okay? But it is exactly the market of methanol. So we can produce methanol from emissions, not anymore from the fossil sources. Okay? It is exactly the same order of magnitude. But they also estimated the fact that since we are debottlenecking the sulfur-rich sources, in the future we can use also sulfur-rich fossil and bio-sources. Don't forget that biomass has inside a little bit of sulfur. Okay? Well, we will attack almost the 9% of the total CO2 release. It is a significant impact. Okay? Well, just a case study. Then I will close the presentation. I will show you just some slides. Coal gasification, you know. Okay, we have also the expert for coal gasification, so we will have also your presentation, of course. And this is a General Electric scheme, very broad scheme, and I want to show you the unit operations. We have coal with sulfur steam, oxygen air, gasification, dewatering, sweetening process, and without the AG2S technology. Without it, CO2 is released and H2S is burned. With the technology, we take these etching gases, the emissions, we convert them, and we obtain more sea gas and less CO2. Okay? Clear the loop? We are not touching anything at the coal gasifier, we are just using what is exiting from the gasifier, and we are converting it to additional product. Okay? Well, my special acknowledge to Supercargo, because we spent also some period to develop a special suite for gasification, where you can identify the models, the trends inside the coal gasifier there, and so on. But no problem. We have, at the end, an estimation of the costs. You remember the capital costs that my colleague mentioned before? How much it costs? We are speaking about CO2. We are not using resources. We are not, but at the end, if it costs 1 million, 1 billion, we are speaking about nothing. Okay? If we want to change an existing plant, which is a medium-sized gasifier, okay? Well, the cost is $7 million for the refurbishing. So we need to change some units to introduce one new, and that's all. Okay? And the payback of the refurbishing is less than 3 years, but it is very conservative calculation, and we are just considering the serious value. Okay? So we are not considering CO2, sulfur market, the fact that we can pay less the resources, and so on. Okay? So it sounds interesting. Okay? Then, some application areas, these are the application areas. If you have a couple of days, I can show you everyone. Do you have? Okay, much better to be short, and I will close the session, almost finished. Well, I show you just 4 slides from these red ones. Okay? Well, first one, natural gas field. Look, this is very interesting. Who is working in natural gas? One, two, no one. Okay, who is working in oil shale? Coal gasification? Are you working on something? No? Okay. Go. What are you doing? What are you doing? What's your topic, main topic? Are you Master of Science, thesis student, PhD student? What's your topic? Which field? To methane. So hydrogenation. Hydrogenation. So, the synthetic natural gas is an existing process. It's very similar to this. Okay? You have just some connection in this point. No problem. I have two slides for it. Okay. Let's show you this one. Only if is it of interest? I just show you another one. Okay? On shale, this one. I feel that this one maybe is the best one. Okay, so. This is an oil refinery. Oil refinery. In the oil refinery, we need hydrogen. We need a lot of hydrogen. Okay? It is probably the most important step in oil refineries. And to do so, we use the steam methane reforming. So we have some naphtha or methane, okay, that is entering the steam reforming. Let's say that we are using 100%. Okay? 100%, qualitative one. Then, since we are using 100%, we can use the stoichiometry of steam to have the steam reforming of the naphtha. Okay, really, in real plant, we are using 400. But let's take theoretical. Okay? Okay, so thanks to this, we need also at least, if it is very well optimized steam reforming, we need 50% of naphtha in the fireworks. We need to heat. It is endothermic. Okay? So fireworks sign, we need to burn methane, and into the process tubes we are reforming the naphtha. Okay? So in this unit we are generating 165% of flue gases given this number. Okay? Good. You know it? Okay. Then we have to take a shift because we want to convert it into hydrogen. Then we have pressure swing absorption. Okay? We need to remove CO2 and put in the hydrogen, and that's all. Good, you know this process? It is here 50 kilometers by way. That's the size of a family. Okay? Well, after the PSA, the hydrogen is used for hydrodesulfurization process. We have the oil with sulfur, and then we want just oil. No sulfur. So the hydrogen goes into H2S. Then we burn this and we vent this. Look, look now with the technology. CO2, H2S, technology, loop of syngas, water gas shift, more hydrogen. Thanks to the emission, more hydrogen. If we have more hydrogen, we have less naphtha at the beginning because we already have some hydrogen. Okay? Less naphtha, less steam, less fireworks. Oops. Less combustion. less CO2 free gases, less CO2 from the PC. A lot of benefits, just reducing what we are burning today. Okay, this is just qualitative one. Okay. Well, this is the last slide. Think a little bit forward. Well, this is the most impacting process worldwide. After power, okay, we have methanol synthesis. More than 60% is the methanol is synthesized by coal gasification. You will correct me. Okay, not sure, but let's say that 63-65% is the slice. Then coal gasification, the water, sweetening, emissions, synthesis, methanol. Given 100% here, we obtain 60% of methanol. Okay? Well, if we use the technology, these are converted into additional syngas, and we have a surplus of methanol. But how much more? Well, it depends on how much H2S we have. Okay? So really we can think to make some optimization in this process. Okay? Good. Well, just concluding, we are preventing the formation thanks to renewables. Then we are capturing pre-post combustion thanks to CCS. Then we are not yet reusing. Just less than 1%, we have seen at the beginning of my talk. Okay? Now, especially after the Horizon 2020 in Europe, we will have a huge program on CO2 reuse. Huge program. So we need to be ready for it. You need to be ready for it. Okay? There's ESC proposals, or CSA proposals, IA proposals, are for you. Okay? Well, the key point is that it seems that the CO2 in the atmosphere will be, very probably in the next 20, 50 years, will be the only carbon source for chemistry and process engineering. So we will take the CO2 from the atmosphere and we will go to chemical synthesis. Okay? But it's up to you. Not me, eh? Okay? So, H2S is a little bit contributing. Now, special thanks to Sotacarbon, developing the pilot here, also managing the pilot. We have very good integrated program. Special thanks to Viscolube, because we are now at the front-end engineering design phase for installing the first industrial plant. And then taking 10 senior technicians to EPC, Engineering, Procurement and Construction Societies, that are supporting us, because we are not a society, we are just an academic institution, okay, so we need some support. And this is the group that is collaborating. Carlo, you know, he had the first presentation, we are together, we are managing, he's managing the industrial side, industrial chemistry side, and managing the chemical engineering side. We have a large group with six colleagues and 20 collaborators. So, half of them are involved in this research activity. So thank you very much also for additional time.
Thank you, Fabio. Let's take one question if you have.
Oh, I forgot to tell you that the organizer told me that this presentation will be the final exam of your certificate. Okay? So.